So benfotiamine is a synthetic version of thiamine, also known as vitamin B1. And you need your vitamin B1 because it's essential for many of the body's functions. And among the 13 known vitamins, vitamin B1 happens to be one of the most important ones for diabetics. But thiamine doesn't raise your B1 levels nearly as much as benfotiamine does, the lab version. That's because benfotiamine is far more bioavailable, which we'll look at in just a second. We'll also look at the science of how it works in the body, why exactly it's being used, things you need to expect while taking it, and most importantly, how much of it do you need to take? Also, real quick before we get started, it would mean the world to me if you hit the like button down below for the YouTube algorithm and turn the bell on next to it to stay up to date with new weekly videos. It's important to start off with what the purpose of thiamine is for in the body. Why do we even need B1? Well, thiamine is essential to help the body produce proteins and fats while helping to metabolize carbohydrates. But interestingly, thiamine does one of the biggest jobs in the body. It develops the mitochondrial membrane. And speaking of the mitochondria, it has that special folding to increase surface area, which in turn increases ATP production. So you could imagine how important that role is. But arguably an even bigger task it's responsible for is supporting the function of the synaptic membrane so that our neurons can continue communicating with one another. Which we will come to why that's important in just a second. But the problem is that thiamine is just water soluble. It can't get into the tissues like benfotiamine can. And benfotiamine was created in the 1950s in Japan to solve this very issue. How can we get the thiamine into more places in the body? One way they did this was to add on this phosphate group, which seemed to help it reach the muscles, brain, and liver, and kidney more efficiently, which soon became marketed to help with diabetic sensorimotor polyneuropathy, where your longer nerve fibers are affected to a greater degree than your shorter ones because nerve conduction velocity is slowed in proportion to a nerve's length. This is why for some, a balance and coordination problem can happen with neuropathy. So this is the first use case of benfotiamine, neuropathy from diabetes complications, which has potential to affect essentially any organ system and can cause a range of symptoms, burning, prickling sensations, feeling achy or dull, even a pins and needles sensation is common too. That's why for some, taking benfotiamine helps them in these symptoms. And it's a lot of the time that advanced glycated end products to be blamed, which forms as a result of having too much sugar in your cells. Not to forget to mention a host of other conditions advanced glycated end products or AGEs can have once your proteins and lipids get glycated. So that's the first condition. The second condition in which benfotiamine is used is improving cognition in Alzheimer's disease. This is because there are several neurodegenerative issues which have been associated with diminished activity of thiamine-dependent enzymes. This includes Parkinson's, Huntington's, and Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome, so less thiamine for these folks. How exactly vitamin B1 affects this? Well, we have literature on the therapeutic potential of thiamine and benfotiamine just back from November of 2023 that GSK, which is a glycogen synthase kinase that has been involved in tau phosphorylation and the production and accumulation of beta amyloid in these mice, which are actually the two major causes of Alzheimer's. You get beta amyloid plaques that grow on the brain and these tau protein neurofibrillary tangles. Well, it turns out that GSK causes this, and that benfotiamine stops this from happening in mice by phosphorylating it or by inhibiting it. Later on in the study, it mentioned that the dosing that was used, and this is by the way where we can identify some type of recommended dose, it mentions a 2016 small uncontrolled clinical study on 5 patients with mild to moderate Alzheimer's disease. They found that daily supplementation with 300 milligrams of benfotiamine during 18 months had improved the cognitive abilities of patients independently of brain amyloid accumulation. So that's the first one. Yes, it's a small one, but in 2020, Gibson et al. Performed double-blind early phase 2 randomized placebo-controlled clinical trial to assess whether benfotiamine is safe, efficacious, and feasible for patients with mild cognitive impairment or mild dementia. Patients were treated again with 300 milligrams of benfotiamine or placebo twice a day for 12 months. Benfotiamine treatment was safe and effective in raising thiamine concentrations in the periphery. So that's great. We can see it got into the periphery. But importantly, Benfotiamine was effective in suppressing cognitive decline as measured by Alzheimer's disease assessment scale and the clinical dementia rating. But here's how it ties back to neuropathy from earlier. It also reduced increases in advanced glycation end products. Now that we got through what benfotiamine is, what it's used for, and the dosing being that 300 milligrams twice a day, which I left one that I like in the description below as my affiliate, let's talk about how realistic a thiamine deficiency is in healthy adults. It's not that common actually, because you can find vitamin B1 in a lot of foods. Raisins, avocados, and jackfruit seem to have a lot of it. But then again, you have to be aware of what can interfere with it in the body. Now, most people would not have this in their diets, but I wanted to point it out anyway. From two small studies in Thailand, chewing slices of areca nut wrapped in betel leaves and chewing tea leaves in general reduced food thiamine bioavailability because of the high amount of tannins.
When betel nut, betel leaf, and slaked lime are wrapped up together in a little packet to be chewed, it's called a betel quid.
Making up the quid is an art. A slice of areca nut is smeared with tinted lime and wrapped in the leaf of the peppery betel plant.
The contents and ingredients of the quid vary greatly depending on tradition or practice. Sometimes betel quid contain tobacco or have cardamom, clove, or other spices added for extra flavor.
And also the pupae of the African silkworm, which is a traditional food in Nigeria, can cause a thiamine deficiency too. Then there are some reports of eating fermented raw fish could lower your thiamine as well. Other factors like being on long-term diuretics, bariatric surgery, and alcoholism can all remove thiamine from your body. But always consult with your doctor if you fall into this group before making a decision on thiamine. It's important they know your entire list of supplements you're taking so that it can help you optimize them to the fullest. Because on average, studies show that benfotiamine relieves pain after 2 weeks of treatment. That's great. After a couple of weeks, you can feel the improvement in sensation and peripheral nerve function again. But with that said, it's important you check your beta cell function and glucose levels before and after starting benfotiamine. And if you have pain in your nerves, first check in with your doctor. There may be better solutions for you than just relying on benfotiamine. But I'm more curious to hear from you guys though. What are your thoughts on this? Leave them in the comments below. And until then guys, I'll see you on the next one.